call on the telephone. I don't know.
Welcome back to Star Wars Delusions of Granular with your host Ron, and without me this week, JP. As it turns out, talked to JP this week. He's been telling us that he's on leave because his wife's having a baby, and we wish him well. But it turns out that's not entirely true. Long-time listeners of the show, you might be familiar with JP's love of the producer of many hit shows in the 70s and 80s, Glenn Larson. Well, JP's been not having a baby, but actually just marathoning all the episodes of BJ and the Bear and Sheriff Lobo. So, yeah, that's what he's been doing, folks. Instead of recording for, all of our listeners out there and talking about the minutiae of Star Wars, he needs help, folks. That's what I'm saying. He is addicted to BJ and the Bear, and it's becoming a problem. So, if he is having a baby, we need to stop this now, because he cannot be corrupting his baby with BJ and the Bear. Can't. All right, folks. You are listening to Delusions of Granular. We're a Star Wars podcast. We talk about Star Wars every week. We get granular with a new Star Wars topic every week. You can find all of our shows at delusionsofgranular.com. You can also subscribe to us on iTunes or Stitcher. Leave us a message at swdog77@gmail.com. You can always like us on Facebook at facebook.com/swdog, or follow us on Twitter at swdog77, or leave us a phone call at 651-33-SWDOG. That's 651-337-9364. With JP being gone, I'm getting really good at reading off all of our business. So, what are we talking about this week? Well, what am I talking about this week? Well, I just finished reading the Dark Deception novel, the latest in canon novel that we're receiving in the new Star Wars universe. Everything counts now. All the novels, all the comics count. This one was written by a woman by the name of Christy Golden, who is actually quite a sci-fi writer in herself. She has quite a resume. She's written a few other Star Wars books, and she's written as well as some other books for other sci-fi franchises. But this particular book, it was actually based on some unproduced episodes from the Star Wars Clone Wars TV series. You know, we all know that was canceled before it actually had a chance to really finish out. You know, there was a lot of unproduced episodes, semi-produced episodes. You know, we got some of the episodes came by way of comic books. You know, the Darth Maul arc, Sons of Dathomir, that JP and I both were kind of lukewarm on. But this was actually an unproduced 8-episode arc, which, folks, if you're familiar with the Clone Wars TV series, 8-episode arc, that's pretty long. That's, you know, like 1/3 of a series, a season. Most of our arcs usually lasted 3-4 episodes, and 4 episodes really felt like a long arc. But this was a 8-episode arc. 8-episode arc, written by a bunch of writers, but one art writer in particular, Katie Lucas. Katie Lucas, who JP and I became familiar through the Clone Wars. She is obviously George Lucas's daughter, one of his daughters, and she wrote some of I know JP and I some of our favorite episodes in the Clone Wars. I think she's responsible for some of the Darth Maul episodes, some of the darker episodes, as well as, you know, some of them with Asajj Ventress and Aura Sing. So, you know, these are all great characters that Katie Lucas really kind of fleshed out, kind of side characters in the movie that, you know, were given a chance to really have a second life in the Clone Wars. So, anyway, this was an eight episode arc concentrated on two of my favorite characters that came out of the Clone Wars, Asajj Ventress and Quinlan Vos. Now, you may remember from a handful of episodes back, we did an episode about the gray area, basically Force users in the Star Wars universe that not necessarily dark side, not necessarily light side. You know, they kind of fall into that gray area. Quinlan Vos was definitely fell into that. Asajj Ventress definitely fell into that. So as soon as this book was announced, I was very much looking forward to this. I think that this gray area, talking about Force users, is really an interesting area to kind of delve into. Asajj Ventress, what we did see in the Clone Wars, I always thought was pretty interesting. She really got her start in the animated version, the Cell animated version of the Clone Wars. You know, it was before the actual show took off with the CGI rendered Clone Wars. It was real episodic shorts. You know, they were only a few minutes long, but that's when we really got to see this Force user that was kind of a Sith, kind of a badass. You know, a female Sith. I think she used two red lightsabers. I might be wrong there, but we ended up seeing more of her in the actual CGI version of the Clone Wars. She had quite an arc. She was kind of betrayed by her master, Count Dooku, and she, turns against him, kind of walks away from being a Sith, which is just in itself very interesting. You know, we've talked in the past about Ahsoka Tano being a favorite of ours in the Clone Wars, and how her arc, turns out, the way she walks away from the Jedi Order. So this, in a way, parallels Ahsoka's arc with Asajj Ventress walking away from the Sith. She was also a Night Sister, which, kind of learn a lot more about if you watch the Clone Wars series. They're not necessarily, I guess they're kind of witches. They have Force powers, but they're not Sith. Darth Maul from the same planet. He's kind of a brother, but not really connected to the Night Sisters. So anyway, Asajj Ventress has a really interesting story, and you can actually find out a lot, really a full arc from her if you just watch the series proper itself. The other main character in this book is Quinlan Vos. Quinlan Vos, we talked about before. He's this rogue Jedi, very much a part of the Jedi Order, as it turns out, in canon. He was born in the Jedi Temple. So he's been a Jedi for quite a long time, but he, he's kind of known of being a little bit rough around the edges, kind of breaking the rules somewhat in the way that Qui-Gon Jinn did, but he's a little bit more sarcastic and has a, kind of a sense of humor about himself. Kind of gets on Obi-Wan Kenobi's case a lot. He's kind of the opposite of Obi-Wan Kenobi. Obi-Wan is always been portrayed in the Clone Wars as being the straight arrow, and Quinlan Vos is more of the loose cannon. So it's nice to see him really kind of get fleshed out a little bit more in this novel, because he really wasn't in the Clone Wars show itself very much. I think he was only in maybe a couple episodes. But I really did enjoy him and what we did get of him. And he actually has his a lot of Dark Horse comics. You can actually pick up a whole Star Wars omnibus of just his stories. And, I don't think he's portrayed as well in the comics. I think they were still getting a handle on who he is. I think he's portrayed more as kind of this American Indian type, very serious Jedi in the Clone. I'm sorry, in the comic books, but in the Clone Wars, he's kind of more of a. You know, he's kind of got like dreadlocks, a little bit more Jamaican, a little bit more laid back, a little bit more, you know, just a easygoing guy. You know, apparently, and I think we mentioned this before on the show, but he actually is seen in the Phantom Menace in the background when they're on Tatooine. Just kind of walking through the marketplace, Jar Jar Binks gets himself into trouble, and Quinlan Vos can kind of be seen in the background. You blink and you miss him. I honestly don't even think that's really him. I think that's just, you know, them trying to insert this character into the movie after the fact, not by CGI or anything. They're like, hey, this actor might look like Quinlan Vos. Let's just say it was. So anyway, they're the main characters of this book. I should say, folks, if you haven't read this book, maybe you might want to turn off the episode now, because I'm definitely going to dive into a lot of spoilers on this book. I will say up front, I do think that this is probably my favorite of the new canon novels that's come out. I really, really enjoyed this book, but I do want to talk freely about it, and there is definitely things that I will say. I'll give a spoiler warning again when I get close to those, but there's definitely things that if you don't want to be spoiled about anything that happens in this book, I would suggest not going any further. With that being said, let's just talk about the synopsis of this book. So the Jedi Council, in their infinite wisdom, decide that, you know, the Clone Wars have been going on too long, and it's just all the senseless violence needs to stop. You know, the Jedi Council, JP and I have talked about the Jedi in the past and our perception of them, especially in the Clone Wars. They are kind of a bunch of idiots. And, they really, you know, they try to be this all-knowing council, and the mistakes that they make, it's just unspeakable. And the mistakes that they make in this book are terrible. But anyway, they decide that, you know, after another episode of senseless violence has broken out and people have died, the only way to really stop the Clone Wars is to actually take it upon themselves as Jedi to assassinate the leader, Count Dooku. That's who they perceive to be the leader. You know, again, they don't really have the knowledge. They're clouded by the dark side that Count Dooku is really just a puppet, that his, you know, strings are attached to Darth Sidious. And at this point in the Star Wars history, the Jedi think that Count Dooku is the leader of the Separatist army, and if they assassinate him, that'll put an end to the war, because the enemy will be without a head. Now, we all know that this is just ludicrous. We know that Darth Sidious, you know, the Emperor Palpatine was really the one pulling all the strings, but you know, the dark side clouded the Jedi mind, so they didn't think that. So they decide to make this controversial decision to have Count Dooku assassinated. Now, the Jedi are not murderers, so this is very, very controversial decision. I believe Obi-Wan is really the only voice of reason here, saying maybe we shouldn't do this. But they elect to have Quinlan Vos be the Jedi that's going to go out and actually try to assassinate Count Dooku. And how are they going to do this? Well, they know that Asajj Ventress has had a falling out with her former master, Dooku. So they said, well, Quinlan, if you can try to befriend Asajj, maybe you can get her help. She has, you know, kind of an inside track on Dooku. Maybe she'll be able to get closer to him than you will. So that's really the crux of the book, is Quinlan Vos kind of going undercover to befriend Asajj and, team up with her so that they can both go off and try to assassinate, murder Count Dooku. Which, you know, aside from the Jedi being kind of idiots here, I'm intrigued by that premise. You know, we have these two characters that are, you know, kind of in the gray, and, you know, we're going to team them up. So, I don't want to go beat by beat into the book, but as it turns out, you know, Quinlan kind of gets under Asajj Ventress's skin. You know, since she has left Count Dooku, she has become a bounty hunter on her own, kind of a rogue bounty hunter. She's in the show itself. She's tried to team up with, you know, the band of bounty hunters that include Boba Fett as the leader, Bossk, a few others off the top of my head I can't think, but if you've seen the show, you know this group. But since then, she's kind of off on her own, and she's kind of doing her own thing, and she prefers to work alone. Quinlan Vos, he kind of goes off and starts interfering with one of her bounties as she's trying to hunt it down. And, kind of in a charming way, kind of wins over her trust. So much so that they form a romance, which I will say, I will give Christy Golden a lot of credit. This I feel is a very believable romance. We have two rough around the edges characters, and they kind of both find comfort in each other. It really brings a lot of emotional impact into the story. We get a lot of just real nice moments between these two. It feels somewhat in a way like the Han and Leia romance in Empire and Jedi, even. It feels a lot more believable than Anakin and Padme. It's just really nice. Now, the logistics of it are if Quinlan, you know, being a Jedi, has no attachments, is not allowed to have attachments. If he wants to stay with Asajj, he has to give up being a Jedi. Ventress, being the "I want to only work alone," she has to kind of give up a little bit of who she is if she wants to stay with him. And there's, you know, like I said, there's a lot of tender moments between the two. It feels very believable. You're kind of rooting for them to be together throughout the book, no matter what happens to Dooku, no matter what the Jedi think. You're really pulling for them to really, you know, make it through to the end of the book as a couple. So, with that being said, and folks, again, this is where some real spoilers come up. Throughout probably about midway through the book, they're very close to capturing Dooku and killing him, but Dooku kind of turns the tables and overpowers Quinlan and Asajj. Quinlan gets captured by Dooku, and Asajj kind of flees in self-preservation, which is a little bit of a slap in the face to Quinlan. He doesn't really know what to think of her for doing this. And as it turns out, Dooku turns Quinlan over to the dark side. Yes, Quinlan becomes a dark side character for a little bit of this book. In fact, it becomes a big part of the book. About at least the last third of the book is kind of like they keep you guessing. Is Quinlan truly, did he truly turn to the dark side or not? You have certain characters believing he did. You have other characters believe that he didn't. You don't really know where he stands throughout the rest of this book. If he's kind of did turn to the dark side, and he's just trying to sabotage the Jedi while pretending like he's on their side, or if he's just faking to be a, you know, faking being the dark side just to kind of get closer to Dooku. Throughout this, Asajj really is, because she was affiliated with the dark side, she kind of has the inside track on, you know, is he or isn't he, and she's the character you really look to trusting her instinct as to whether he is turned or not. I will say this. There is a point that, yes, he did turn, and that he has come back from the dark side. But unfortunately, he comes back too late. The real emotional blow in this book is Asajj Ventress, introduced in the Clone Wars. She dies, folks. She actually gets killed by Count Dooku. He uses some Force lightning on her, and it's too much. It kind of scars her and really ends up destroying her. So that in itself, I think, makes this really an important book to read. If you followed the Clone Wars, if you enjoyed the Clone Wars like JP and I did, this really does bring closure to, unfortunate closure to, one of the fan favorite characters of that book. Asajj, poor Asajj, she ends up dying. Quinlan Vos ends up heartbroken, going back to the Jedi. And, of course, because, you know, this happens before Revenge of the Sith, Dooku gets away, obviously. So, that being said, like I said, I did really enjoy the book. I did want to kind of bring out a few things that I noticed in this. Again, the Jedi Council, they're just so terrible. Like, they, you know, they send Quinlan on this mission, knowing full well the risks involved with Vos getting close to Asajj and or Dooku, the risks of falling to the dark side or getting killed. And sure enough, he does turn to the dark side, and the Jedi Council, Mace Windu and Yoda and them, they kind of blow off responsibility for the actions that they led this character to. And as I said before, Obi-Wan is really the voice of reason in all this. He's like, hey, look, we can't really condemn this man. We're kind of responsible for what happened to him. You know, if we didn't send him on this mission, he wouldn't have fallen to the dark side. You know, and you know, they failed in this mission. You know, the whole point was to kill Dooku, and you know, the council, they are just not all knowing. You know, if they had the foresight, they would have been like, no, this assassination attempt is just going to fail. Why should we even try it? I mean, Mace Windu himself, he really comes off like kind of the real problem here. Yoda seems a little bit confused as to, you know, what to do, but wait, Mace is like, he's quick to condemn, quick to not take any responsibility, which is it's too bad. I as much as I enjoyed this book, I was hoping that the Jedi Council would be a little bit more, have a little bit more depth to them. They still seem to be the very, very bumbling, I don't think bumbling is the right word, but they're just not as wise as we would like the Jedi to be. One of the themes I picked up in the book is, you know, if you fall in love, folks,
that's your first step to turning to the dark side. I don't know if that's true or not, but there's, you know, it seems like any Jedi that falls in love, next step is the dark side. We've seen it with Anakin. You know, we've seen it with Quinlan Vos. There is a funny aside to this book. Anakin, Obi-Wan, Padme, they play side characters in this. Like I said, Obi-Wan is kind of the voice of reason throughout this entire book. Anakin, he's in it. I wouldn't say he's there for comic relief, but Anakin in his own way is kind of comic relief. There is a point where he goes home to Padme and is like, hey, have you heard the news, the rumors? Quinlan Vos, he's leaving the Jedi Order because he's in love with Asajj Ventress. You know, a Jedi is in love with someone. You know, how messed up is that? And Padme's like, Anakin, you do realize we're living together, right? And I'm pregnant. You know, like, he kind of plays just like the completely clueless Jedi, which is amusing. I found it amusing. I wish that the Clone Wars series actually had more Quinlan Vos in it. I really did enjoy him in this book. I wish there was a way that they could have fit him into more storylines. I think he would have been a great addition to some of the previous story arcs that we have watched in the Clone Wars. Obviously, his character still has a future, so maybe he'll show up in Rebels. I would love to see more of him. I think he's a really good character, despite his flaws, despite what happened to him, and his, you know, him losing his love in this book. Just a random thought here. Do you think, or I had this thought, women authors, Christy Golden, do they make better Star Wars novelists than men? Not trying to be sexist here, but I just think that, I don't know, this story really brought a greater depth to these characters. I never felt like I was in, there was any worry that Christy Golden was going to revert to using the old Star Wars tropes. You know, never did I worry that we're going to end up hearing once again, I have a bad feeling about this, or, you know, all the overused lines. I never thought there was going to be any callbacks to that. I just really was engrossed in the story, in the characters themselves, more so than I am with, like, a lot of the other books written by male authors. I don't know. Just a thought. Katie Lucas obviously has a handle on these characters as well. I don't know. Again, not trying to be sexist or anything. Just something to throw out there. I kind of like women authors better, but for the Star Wars novels. But I don't know. Finally, I was discussing this book with JP, and I was telling him what happened to this, and we were talking about this. And I wanted to leave you with this question because JP and I had this question amongst ourselves. Do we feel cheated, or are we okay that Asajj got a conclusion to her story? You know, do we feel cheated that she didn't get a conclusion on screen, or are we okay that she got her conclusion at least in a novel form? You know, would it have been better to see this play out? Would it have been better if she had lived and just, you know, had her conclusion play out in a different media form? You know, what if she showed up in The Force Awakens? You know, I don't know. Just something we were questioning. Like, you know, obviously the series was cut short for business reasons. It's good that they gave her a conclusion to, you know, this character. But what if she did live? What if we did get to actually see her and Quinlan Vos have a happy ending and, you know, ride off into the sunset and not be Jedi and not be Sith and actually just kind of, you know,
do something different, bring something new to the Star Wars universe. But instead, you know, Quinlan ends up taking her back to her home planet, and, you know, kind of does the traditional funeral of the Night Sisters for her. And Quinlan Vos goes back to being a Jedi, and it's, you know, status quo as usual. As much as I enjoyed the book, at the end of the day, nothing really changed. You know, nothing new was added to the Star Wars universe that would really kind of shake things up. You know, are we ever going to get that in books, or is that just something that's going to be left to the movies? I don't know. Just something to think about. I think JP and I, we as we discuss this stuff amongst ourselves, I think what we were really hoping will happen eventually is something will happen in a comic, a TV show, or a novel, and it'll actually really kind of trigger real change, real events that will move on into the movies, into, you know, further storytelling, instead of just kind of being left just in, you know, kind of change happens, but then everything is neatly wrapped up at the end of whatever book or comic book you're reading, and, you know, everything is left the way it started out. So I don't know. I mean, we did lose a major character in this. I do consider Asajj Ventress a major character. I do put her up there with Ahsoka Tano as far as the character depth that we received, whether it is in the Clone Wars or in novels or what we're going to hopefully get from Ahsoka Tano and Rebels. Asajj Ventress, you will be missed. I think I will miss that she will not be around in anything future. But all in all, good story. Good on you, Christy Golden. I will definitely be picking up some of your other novels and diving in, because I really did enjoy that, folks. So, with that being said, I think I will leave you until next week. Stay granular.
My appeal. I need a chance, a second chance, a third chance, a fourth chance, a word, a signal, not a little breath, just to fool myself, catch myself, make it real.